الفاتحة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والجنة للمطيعين والنار للعاصين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وأعز المرسلين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وبآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين الذين ذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا أما بعد فقد قال الله الحكيم فيه محكم كتابه المبين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وجاءت سكرة الموت بالحق ذلك ما كنت منه تحيد آمنا بالله وصدق الله العلي العظيم Please recite salawat. My brothers and sisters in Iman, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is not my first time in Edmonton. If you remember, I was here 2 years ago during the first Ashra of Muharram. Normally, I do not go for two Ashras in a year. But there is no doubt that it was your friendship, it was your love, it was your respect and hospitality that was accorded to me during my last visit that drew my heart towards accepting your invitation and coming here to recite the last few majalis of Ashra-i Zainabiyya. These are the days that are leading us towards the Arba'een, towards the Chahlum of Imam Abu Abdullah al-Husayn, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, and that of the Shuhada of Karbala. We therefore pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He should accept our azadari which we have performed during these days, and may He give us the tawfiq, the blessings, to understand whatever we have learned from these majalis during these days and implement them, bring them into practice, insha'Allah. The topic which I have chosen for these 5 or 6 days I will be with you is something which many people do not want to hear. But learning always begins when you remove people from their zones of comfort and inform them about the realities that await all of us. My brothers, my sisters, my topic of discussion will inshallah be about maut, about death and preparation for the afterlife. The reason why I have chosen to discuss on this subject is not to scare mu'mineen, it is not to put off mu'mineen, rather to make them ponder, to make them think about the life which awaits us. so that we are able to reform ourselves in this life and prepare ourselves for what is awaiting us. In the beginning of my talk, I have recited verse number 19 of Surah Qaf, which is the 50th chapter of the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forewarning us. He is telling us, وَجَاءَتْ سَكْرَةُ الْمَوْتِ بِالْحَقِّ ذَلِكَ مَا كُنْتَ مِنْهُ تَحِيدٌ. And the agony of death will come in truth. That is what you are trying to escape. Many of us think that the day of Qiyamah, the day of judgment, is very far. All the prophets who came into this world for the guidance of mankind informed and cautioned their people about the day of Qiyamah, about the day of judgment. Hundreds or even thousands of years have passed since they have departed from this world, yet we see that the day of judgment has not occurred. And perhaps it will take hundreds or thousands of more years before this day actually occurs. So the question that comes to mind is that why should we reform ourselves and perform good deeds and prepare ourselves for that day, which will occur after hundreds or thousands of years? Why? Kyun ab se tayari kare? Why should we? There is no doubt that the day of Qiyamah may occur hundreds or thousands of years later. The knowledge of its occurrence is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He has said this very openly in the Holy Quran. People ask you concerning the day of Qiyamah. Allah is telling His beloved Prophet, tell them that its knowledge lies only with Allah, nobody else. So we do not know when it will occur. But yes, it is possible that it may occur hundreds or thousands of years later. But let us not forget that Barzakh, the name which has been given to life after this life, that is life after death, is only few steps away from all of us and can occur at any time. Barzakh is the name given to the life which is between this life and the life of Qiyamah, the day of judgment. We will be talking about this, inshallah, in one of our lectures. But there is a reality that awaits all of us. Death can happen to anybody, anywhere and at any place. I remember a few years ago, a young man of 25 or 26 years traveled from Nairobi during the month of Dhul-Hijjah with the intention of performing his first wajib hajj. This young man was fit and healthy and full of life. People who knew him could not even think that this man is going to go for Hajj and will not even be able to perform his wajibat and will pass away from this world. The young man reaches Medina before going to Mecca, falls seriously ill and passes away, and shocks his family members and his friends and the people who had traveled with him for Hajj. It's a reality, something that has happened and will continue happening. Immediately after this month of Dhul-Hijjah, when this young man passed away, another young man came from Dar es Salaam to Nairobi for some business. It was during the first 12 days of Muharram. Whilst in Nairobi, he met his business associates and also participated in some of the majalis at the center. Met his friends, met his relatives. On his way back to Dar es Salaam, he met up with an accident and passed away, leaving behind a young wife and young children. I have left my home and traveled all the way to Edmonton. I am not sure whether I will return to my home or not. I am sitting here on this member reciting madlis. I am talking to you. You are listening to me. There is no assurance, there is no guarantee that I will complete my madlis and come down of this pulpit. Indeed, there have been ulama, scholars who have passed away whilst reciting majalis. Shaykh Muhammad Jawad al-Mughniya, Ridwanullahi alayhi, a great Shia scholar, passed away whilst he was reciting madlis on a member in Damascus, inshallah. A great scholar who has authored many books. I know of people, of scholars, of Zakirin who recited majlis and after coming down from the pulpit, they passed away in presence of the people, right before their eyes. You have left your homes and you have come to this center. You have got so many things running in your minds, isn't it? That when we go back, we have to do this, we have to do that. People are in a hurry because you have to get to work tomorrow. You have already planned what you are going to do tomorrow. But how sure are you that you will make it to your homes after this madlis? Is there anybody who can get up and claim here that I know for certain that nothing is going to happen to me and that I will go home? Absolutely not. So what I am trying to share with you is that it is true that perhaps the day of Qiyamah, the day of judgment, may occur hundreds or thousands of years later. But Barzakh, which is the name given to life after death, is just few steps away. Therefore, it is very important, it is very essential that we do not undermine this subject. We learn from the Holy Quran and from the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam what awaits us after that, so that we are able to reform ourselves now and prepare for that life. My brothers and my sisters, we become very uncomfortable talking about death. The subject of death frightens us. I know I've been to some places, and there was a place where actually I conducted a whole ashra on this subject. Initially, people attended my majalis, and gradually I saw that they had stopped attending. So I asked them, where are the people? You talk about this life, you don't talk about that life. In reality, that is the true life that awaits all of us. It frightens us. People are not only afraid of death, they are also afraid of dead bodies. There are some people who would not come near ghusl khana when a dead body is being washed, or for that matter, even if there is no dead body in that ghusl khana. People are afraid to go. It frightens us. But according to Quran and Hadith, death is not as bad as we consider it to be. According to Holy Quran and the narrations from the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, we find that death is regarded as one of the creations, khalq, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is also one of His ni'mat, one of His bounties upon us. With regard to death being a creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the opening of Surah Al-Mulk, تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء خدير. I'm sure you are aware of this surah, Surah Al-Mulk, in the Holy Quran. It is recommended that we recite this surah every night before we retire, before we sleep. Any person who recites this surah before sleeping at night shall be absolved from the wahshat of qabr. It is there mentioned in riwayat. When somebody passes away, we give importance to recitation of Surah Yasin, but it is highly recommended that at that time, Surah Al-Mulk should be recited for that marhum, because there is a possibility that he will be absolved from the difficulties of grave. In the opening of this surah, we'll find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ وَهُوَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ خَدِيرٍ. Blessed is he in whose hand is the kingdom. وَهُوَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ And he has power over everything. Then immediately after this, he says, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا He who created death and life so that he can put you to a test. He can test you who amongst you is best in his conduct, in his deeds. We'll find that in this ayah, Allah is telling us that just like this life, death, maut is also his creation. And the interesting bit is that in this verse, Allah is first talking about death and then life. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ One who created death and life. Why? Isn't death supposed to come after life? According to Mufassirin, one of the reasons why Allah has mentioned death before life as his creation is because the true life is the one which is after death and not this one. An-nasu niyam, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam has said that men are asleep, so rahe hain log. Idha matu intabahu. The day they die, that is the day they will wake up from their slumber. And that is why we'll find that death has been mentioned before. And with regard to death being one of the bounties, ni'mats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, had it not been for death, then this life would be meaningless. Had it not been for death, then there would be no peace for us in this life. A beautiful hadith has been related from our sixth Imam, Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. He was sitting with his companions and he was talking about death. And he told them that during the days of one of the prophets, people came to him and complained to him about death. They said, Ya Nabi Allah, there is one thing that is bothering us, and that is death. So do us a favor, pray to Allah that he should grant us, he should give us permanent life in this world, and that he should not cause us to die. It was a request which people brought. And we too wish the same, isn't it? Kash, hum hamesha ke liye zinda rehte, isn't it? The Prophet of Allah tried to explain to them that this is not possible because this is the Nizam which Allah has created. But they insisted, they said, nah, your duty is that you pray and see what Allah responds. The Prophet of Allah raised his hand and said, Ya Allah, you are aware of everything. You have knowledge of everything. You know what has happened. But I have to convey the request, the wish of my people to you. It is their desire to live in this world permanently and not to die. So they do not want you to cause death for them. Interestingly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the dua and said, Oh my Prophet, go and tell them. They wish to live longer, permanently, no problem. I have lifted death. Nobody henceforth will die in that community, in that society. When people were informed, they were extremely happy. Bahut khush ho gaye, extremely happy. They celebrated this and started rejoicing. Why should a person who knows with certainty that he will not die not rejoice? Huh? And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us from the evil schemes of those people who think they shall never die. They started rejoicing, celebrating, but as time passed by, after many, many years, a time came when a person would wake up in the morning, he would not have his own responsibilities, huh? But he would also have responsibilities of his parents, his grandparents, his great-grandparents. And some of them had become so old and frail that they could not eat unless they were fed. And then illness and sickness of all kind crept into society and life became miserable. It became miserable for the people. The same people who had asked the Prophet to pray to Allah to lift death and that they should not die came back to the Prophet of their time and said, Ya Nabi Allah, we are fed up of this life. Pray to Allah that He should cause us to die so that at least we can live peacefully in this world. Death was then brought back to them. So death, my brothers and sisters, is from amongst the bounties, amongst the ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we will find that the same death has also been referred to as qiyamat sughra, meaning the minor version of qiyamat. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam has said, Man mata faqad qamat qiyamatuhu. One who dies, his qiyamat begins. It means that death will be source of salvation for some, and for some it will be beginning of agonies and difficulties depending on their beliefs and their practices, their deeds which they had performed. When our first Imam, Imam Amirul Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, was asked about death, our Imam responded, beautiful hadith of our Imam, and this is from our first Imam. He said, it is one of the three things happening to a dying person, our Imam said. Either he is receiving glad tidings of eternal bliss, or bad tidings of the perpetual punishment, or it is a vague threatening suspense for him. This is what the Imam said. And then he went on to explain. He said, as for those who love us and follow our teachings, they follow on our path, these are the people who will receive glad tidings at the time of their death. As for those who are our enemies and adversaries, who are against our teachings and they do not follow us, these are the people who will receive bad tidings of the perpetual punishment. And as for a believer who had committed sins in this life, he will not know what will happen to him. Such a person will of course be punished, but if he was also a believer, then eventually he may be rescued by us through our shafa'ah, through our intercession. So death is a creation of Allah, true. Death is one of the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, true. But let us not forget that it is also qiyamat al-sughra, a minor version of qiyamah. Hence we'll find that wisdom dictates for the believers that they should strive in this life to reform themselves and prepare themselves for what is awaiting them after death. My brothers and my sisters, death is a reality which nobody can deny. It is something that is going to happen whether a person believes in it or not, whether a person prepares himself for it or not, whether a person fears it or not, it is something that is going to happen. It is possible that a person may deny the existence of God. It is possible that a person may deny the existence of what is hidden, concealed from his eyes. That is ghaib, ilm ghaib. As believers, we have to believe in ghaib. We have to believe in the angels. We have to believe in Jannah. We have to believe in Jahannam. These are all in ghaib, isn't it? It is one of the signs of believers. Alif, lam, mim, zalikal kitabu la rayba fihi. Allah says in the opening of Surah Al-Baqarah, Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. That is the book. There is no doubt in it. خُدًا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. It is guidance for those who are God-weary and God-conscious in their lives. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those who believe in unseen. So a believer who claims that he believes in Allah and His Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt, but does not believe in the things that are related to ghaib, is a liar, is not truthful in his claim. He's not a mu'min, he's not a believer. So there is a possibility that a person may deny what is there in ghaib, but death is a reality which nobody can deny, can no, nobody can refute, nobody can say that I am not going to die. And it is something which nobody can escape. There is no way a person can escape from death. Yes, in this life it is possible that a person may escape from situations that threaten his life. May be able to escape. In 1972, there was a mass exodus from Uganda. Many mu'mineen here are from Uganda, I believe. When their lives and their properties were threatened by Idi Amin, they escaped from Uganda. Most of them settled in Kenya. Some came to the United Kingdom. Some of them have settled in North America. And there are some in USA as well. In 1990, when people felt threatened in Somalia, again there was an exodus. People migrated from there. They ran away. They escaped from there. They left everything behind. They left their homes and their properties, their businesses, whatever they possessed, they left. Why? To save their lives and that of their family members. Again, they came to Kenya, they came to Tanzania to settle. Some of them migrated to the United Kingdom, North America, and we see. So it is possible for a person to escape from situations that threaten him, that threaten his life, that threatens his properties. He can leave one place and migrate to another. But death is a reality. When the appointed time will come, nobody will be able to escape from it. Sab taat parar hi jayega. Everything he will have to leave behind. And we will find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very clear about this in the Holy Quran. The verse which I recited in the beginning of my talk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَاءَتْ سَكْرَةُ الْمَوْتِ بِالْحَقِّ ذَٰلِكَ مَا كُنْتَ مِنْهُ تَحِيرٌ. And the agony of death will come in truth, whether you believe in it or not, whether you fear it or not, whether you prepare yourself for it or not, it will come. It is haq. It is truth. It is going to come. ذَٰلِكَ مَا كُنْتَ مِنْهُ تَحِيرٌ. Then Allah is saying, this is what you are trying to escape. This is what you are trying to shun in your life. In another verse of the Holy Quran, we will find a beautiful verse in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يُدْرِكُمُ الْمَوْتُ وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدًا. Wherever you are, جَهَابِيُوتُمْ. Wherever you are, death will most certainly overtake you. وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدًا. Even if you are in lofty towers, it is going to reach you. Just as risk sustenance reaches you, death is going to reach you. We recite Surah Jum'ah on every Friday, isn't it? We attend Namaz Jum'ah. And in Namaz Jum'ah, we recite Surah Al-Jum'ah. In this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling his beloved prophet, قل, tell the people, إِنَّ الْمَوْتَ الَّذِي تَفِرُّونَ مِنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ. Indeed, the death which you are trying to flee, which you are trying to escape, فَإِنَّهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ, it will most certainly come and meet you. مُلَاقِيكُمْ is from مُلَاقَات. آئے تم سے ملاقات ضرور کرے گی. You don't have to go to your death. Your death will come to you when your time comes, Allah says. You don't have to rush towards it. It will come. And then what will happen? ثُمَّ تُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ عَالِمِ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَةِ فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. Then you will be returned to the knower of what is seen and what is concealed, what is unseen. And he will inform you of everything you did in your life. So there is no way a person can escape. He can escape from difficult situations in this life, but when the appointed time comes, فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ لَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَقْدِمُونَ. When the appointed time will come, a person will not go 1 hour before or after. جو وقت ہوگا, he has to go. And remember, it will come. Very interesting concept. It will come. Prophet Sulaiman, one of the great prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was bestowed with a huge kingdom on this earth, the kind of which Quran says, لا ينبغي لأحد. the kingdom which was not possible for anybody else besides Prophet Sulaiman. Now the kingdom of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad is different altogether. That is a superior kingdom. We don't want to get into it. But generally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him a king, Solomon or Sulaiman. And he gave him power and control over everything in this life. He did not only control the men, he controlled the jinn. He controlled the animals. He understood the language of the animals, rather the languages of the birds and the animals and the fish that swim in the seas. Everything. And he had command over the wind that was also subservient to Sulaiman. This is Prophet Sulaiman. He was once in his court, and there were emissaries sitting with him, emissary of jinn, emissary of animals, and people, his advisors. The court was full. There's a beautiful incident narrated by our Imam alayhimu salam, very interesting. Death will come to you, so don't worry. Continue with your life. Jo karna hai karo. Don't worry about it. It will come to you. He was conducting his court when suddenly one of the doors opened and a person entered. The person entered. He appeared to be quite strange. And he looked at all the people who were present there. Now you can imagine there's a madlis going on here, and suddenly a person comes and stands by the door, looks at me and looks at everybody here, doesn't enter, doesn't come and sit down. You will wonder what is happening. Kya ho raha hai ye? Hey, kon? Who is he? What is he looking for? He got in. Sulaiman, the king, power over everything. And here is a person who has entered looking in his court, each and every person present. And disappeared. Left. At that time, nobody said anything. As soon as the court was over, one of the followers of Sulaiman, who was a mu'min, came to him and said, "Oh Sulaiman, I have a question to ask." Sulaiman said, "What is it?" He said that this person who entered your court, who was he? Sulaiman said, "Oh, he was Israel, the angel of death, Malakul Maut." As soon as this man heard this, he started trembling. Sulaiman said to him, "Khairiyat to hai? Huh? Are you alright? What's happening?" He said, "Sulaiman, why is it that I feel that he was staring at me most, as though he wanted to remove my soul and take me away with him?" Sulaiman said to him, "Now what do you want me to do? Ab main tere liye kya karu?" He said, "Sulaiman, I've got a request. Allah has given you power and control over everything. You have control over wind as well. Why don't you command the wind to carry me to the land of Hind?" This is mentioned in riwayah, in the days of Prophet Sulaiman, and Hind is in reference to India. Jahan se hamare aba wa ajdad aaye. Said Hind. "So that I am safe from this death." Sulaiman was also a prophet. How could he tell this person that I cannot fulfill your wish and disappoint him? He said, "Fair enough. If you want to go to Hind, I will send you to him." He commanded the wind, "Carry him and take him." The man went. A few days later, Sulaiman alayhi salam met Israel again, the angel of death. He was prophet of Allah. And he could see the angels. He could meet the angels and talk to them. He met the angel of death. He said, "Malakul Maut, I have a question for you." He said, "What is it?" He said, "The other day when you came into my court, why is it that you are staring at Fulan bin Fulan, such and such, for very long? What is the reason?" Listen to this reply.
He said, Sulaiman, what should I tell you? I was commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to extract his soul in the land of Hind. When I came to your court and found him sitting there, I was wondering as to how will I discharge my duty. But guess what? He said, Sulaiman, when I went to him, because this was the command of Allah, I found this man there. And I said, Subhanallah, I removed his soul. I narrated this incident in one of my majalis in East Africa, and a person came to me after my majlis and he said, Maulana Sahib, after this ashra, I was supposed to go to India for medical reasons. I have changed my mind. I'm not going to go to India anymore. Whether you go to India or you don't go to India, wherever, any place you are, wherever you are, at whatever time, when the term, the appointed term by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes, you will have to go. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us very clearly that you do not have to go after your death. The death will come and meet you. So this is the reality, my brothers and my sisters, that awaits us all. The life after death is something which we as believers must talk about it. We must talk about it. We must see what the Holy Quran and the Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wasalam have told us about that life, so that we prepare ourselves for that life. Otherwise, the journey is not going to be easy. Insha'Allah, we will develop more and we will be talking about barzakh and different stages of barzakh that awaits all of us. I have very few days here. It usually takes, I have talked about death in 22 lectures at Wessex. I have only 6 days here. So I'll try and do my best to summarize as much as possible and share with you things that await us so that we are able to prepare ourselves. The followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim assalam, do not fear death. Those who are sincere and strive in this life and persevere on the path shown to them by the Ahlul Bayt, these are the people who do not fear death. In fact, they are looking forward to die. And there is no doubt that the muhibbin, the lovers of Ahlul Bayt, are mushtaq to meet their Lord. Karbala is the best example. Karbala. The people who came to help our Imam, whether they are 72 in number, or 94, or 114, or 124, they are different riwayats. Remember that they were not masooms, they were not infallibles. They were ordinary human beings like you and me. One day, Habib ibn Mudhar was an ordinary person. He was not a ma'asum. He was not an imam. Zuhair Qain, who was there? The people who came with imam. Imagine their psychological state on the night of Ashura. When they knew with certainty that tomorrow there is nothing for us except death. Imagine what was happening to them. What was running in their minds? What were the thoughts that were coming into their minds? But yet we find that in that crucial time of their lives, the final moments of their lives, they persevered. Why? Because they had yaqeen in Imam alayhi salam. They had that faith in our Imam. And we will find that on the night of Ashura, Imam gathered his ashab, his companions, and delivered a sermon. And in that sermon, he has made reference to death and life that awaits them after death. He said to them, Sabran banil kiram, famal mawtu illa qantaratun, tu'abbirukum min al ba'asai wal dharrah ila al jidan al wasi'ah wal na'im al da'ima. Ay nek logo ke farzando, O children of noble men. Famal mawtu illa qantaratun, death is nothing but a bridge. Maut siwai ek pool ke aur kuch nahi. This is Imam telling his ashab. تعبركم من البعساء والضراء، جو تمہیں دنیا کی تکلیفوں اور مشقتوں سے الگ کر کے، which will remove you from the hardships and difficulties of this life. It will take you towards the life that is permanent. It will take you towards paradise. It will take you towards Jannah. This is the khutbah delivered on the night of Ashura. And look at these companions. Having faith in Imam, they stuck to Imam. They fought for Imam. They sacrificed their lives for the sake of Imam, for the sake of Deen, for the sake of Islam. Followers of Ahlul Bayt who are true to their belief, who are true to their faith, who are sincere in their following, strive to err as human. There's no doubt Allah will forgive, provided we worked hard, we strive to remain steadfast on the path of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasallam. There is nothing to worry. And indeed we see that in Karbala they sacrificed their lives, they gave up everything. Radhan bi qada'ihi wa tasliman li amri. We submit ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We want nothing but His rida, His pleasure. My brothers, my sisters, these are the days when we are mourning the masahib, the atrocities that were committed against the Ahlul Bayt after the event of Karbala. People do not value these days. You'll find that everywhere people would come and attend the majalis, participate in the azadari during the first 12 days of Muharram. But as soon as the 12 days of Muharram are gone, are passed, people resume their normal lives and forget everything else. And come Arba'een, they come back to offer their pursa, their condolence to Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam. But let us not forget the people who sacrificed their lives in Karbala with the end of their lives. The musibah, the hardships and difficulties for them are over. But the musibah, the difficulties and hardships that began for Sayyidina Zainab in Karbala was after that. The musibah that befell upon Sayyidina Sajjad, our fourth Imam, and the Ahlul Bayt, the women folk, began after the day of Ashura. Tariq ke andar hume milta hai ki 11th Muharram ko جب آل محمد کا لوٹا ہوا قافلہ کربلا سے روانہ ہونے لگا ہے تو ایک 4 سالہ بچی دوڑتی ہوئی نشیب میں آئی اور ایک لاشے بے سر سے لپٹ کر رونا شروع کی. اتنے میں شمر بے حیا تازیانے لے کر اس بچی کے پاس آیا اور بچی سے کہا کہ چلو سکینہ اٹھو قافلہ جا رہا ہے. 4 سالہ بچی نے شمر کی طرف دیکھا, کہا اے شمر مجھے یہی پر چھوڑ دے, میں یہی پر رہنا چاہتی ہوں. تو شمر ایک مرتبہ ہنس پڑا, کہا سکینہ تو یہاں پر رہ کر کیا کرو گی؟ عجیب جواب سکینہ نے دیا, 4 سالہ بچی تھی, نادان نہیں تھی. کہا شمر میں اپنے بابا کو غسل دوں گی, اپنے بابا کو کفن دوں گی اور اپنے بابا کی قبر بناؤں گی. بس یہ سننا تھا. ایک مرتبہ شمر نے پوچھا کہ سکینہ تو ابھی بچی ہو, یہ سب کام اکیلی کیسے کر لو گی؟ سکینہ نے کہا شمر تو فکر نہ کر, تو جب یہاں سے چلا جائے گا, ارے کبھی تو میرے نانا کے کلمہ گو یہاں سے گزریں گے, بیچ راستے کے میں کھڑی ہو جاؤں گی اور کہوں گے اے مسلمانوں آؤ, ایک پردیسی مارا گیا, ایک غریب الوطن مارا گیا, آؤ اسے غسل دو, اسے کفن دو, اس کی قبر بناؤ. الا لعنت اللہ علی القوم الظالمین وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل بيت محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات, تابع اللهم بيننا وبينهم بالحسنات والخيرات, إنك مجيب الدعوان, إنك قاضي الحاجان, إنك ولي الحسنات, إنك رافع الدرجات, إنك على كل شيء قدير. ماتم حسين.